people of our church's past. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the wonderful people that have gone before us, the saints who have shone a light upon you, upon your church, and shown us the way. Lord, we pray this morning that you would indeed open our hearts and our minds to understand more of you and how you might actually help us to frame our lives with you. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you wander around the walls of our church foyer here, you'll find pictures of this church from days gone by. But strangely, few of them refer to Walkerville Uniting Church. They refer to Walkerville Methodist Church, because that is how this congregation here was first known. And that term Methodist was actually used by people in Oxford to insult the people who were part of that group back in the 1700s. It was an insult. I'm not sure I feel that insulted. However, rather than remaining an insulting term, it became the name of a movement that sought to transform the spiritual heart of England and eventually bring the message of life in Christ to hundreds of thousands of people across the world. And this morning we will look at the life of one of the most instrumental people in that process, John Wesley. John Wesley was born to a family of a devout Anglican minister and his wife, Samuel and Susanna Wesley, in Epworth in 1703. John was born of the 15th of 19 children. Let me say that again. No, I won't say that again. Although, sadly, because of the conditions of the time, 10 of those children died in infancy. Still, pretty good-sized family. And John's mother, Susanna Wesley, being Annesley, as we have Annesley College in Adelaide, understandably, was an organisational whiz, able to organise quite a large household, obviously, particularly given that her husband lacked financial powers and skills, often finding himself in debtor's prison. However, the family seemed to grow up well, and the children well nurtured and educated. Now, sometimes events seem to define us and our understanding of ourselves. It might be that maybe you rescued someone or someone rescued you from an injury which made you realise maybe you should become a doctor, or maybe a nurse, or an ambulance officer, or a firefighter, or whatever it might be. John Wesley had one of those too. His defining moment was when he was at the age of 5, his home caught fire. And Samuel and Susanna managed to get everybody else out, but they lost track of little John. And actually, we go back a slide, please.
Go back a slide.
There we go. See that little loft at the top there? It is understood that that's where his bedroom was. So, he was still asleep. He'd missed all the commotion. But when he woke, he started crying from his window. And a neighbour heard him. And he got up on someone else's shoulders and pulled John from his window, just as the roof collapsed behind him. He remembers that as escaping as if through flames. Both Susanna and John saw God's work in this. John would often look back at that moment and see it as an affirmation that God must have a divine purpose for his life, that God had great things in store for that 5-year-old for the future in gospel work, helping others escape that judgment. So John went with his brother Charles to study at Oxford University, which is where he is up there. And shortly after arriving, they joined with a few others and formed a group to read the Bible, pray, and do works of charity. Much the same as today, these guys copped more than their fair share of ridicule. People called them Bible moths, the Holy Club, and the name that would stick, obviously, Methodists, because they're focused on living such holy lives. However, through all of this, John would later reflect that it was really a refined way of still trusting to his own words and his own righteousness. terms with God rather than trusting in God. So following his studies in theology, back to the church, which is the church where he wound up. In fact, you can probably see three people there. No, not that one. Back again, please. Oh, sorry, no, back forward. Sorry.
You're right.
There's three people then. Dad and my parents and Ali just wandering around the church grounds. Aunt was behind the camera at the time, so for once, Dad was usually behind the camera. So anyway, it wasn't a great surprise that John assisted his father in his parish. He was ordained a deacon in his early 20s, and then an Anglican priest at the age of 25 in 1728. Wesley's reliance on his own works and righteousness, though, was only going to become a more painfully apparent issue in a few years' time. He was set sail from Georgia over in the US following good friend and fellow Methodist, the open-air preacher George Whitfield. Whitfield had a great ministry, initially in England, preaching to crowds of up to 10,000 people in the streets and in the fields. This passion he often took over to America, which is where we see him there, and invited the Wesleys to join him. And the mission trip actually yielded little fruit, but one incident was to have great impact. Because on the way to Georgia by ship, a massive storm blew up. It seriously threatened the ship and everyone sailing within it. Everyone was beside themselves, John Wesley included. That was everyone apart from a group of 26 Moravian Christians. Moravians were a Protestant church from the Czech Republic, originating from the Czech Republic. Somehow, in the midst of this massive storm rending the ship apart, they seemed to be completely calm. It wasn't that they had a better idea of weather patterns or because they were better swimmers even. They had something that John and Charles were both yet to discover. A personal, living trust in Jesus as Lord and Christ. Clearly, they survived and they arrived safely. But those events, they stuck with John. He sought out another fellow, Peter Bowler, another Moravian Christian, when they returned to England. And John attended a Christian society meeting in Aldersgate Street in London. John wasn't that keen to go. But as the preacher was preaching on Luther's introduction to the Book of Romans, and describing the change that God works in a person's heart through faith in Jesus, John felt his own heart in his words. You can read them up there. I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ alone for salvation, and an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. Suddenly he knew the living God. He did know Christ, and he trusted in Christ alone for his salvation, from his sins and his life forever. At Whitfield's urging, John would find himself preaching in fields and towns across England, across Scotland, even Ireland, preaching over 40,000 sermons. I'm going to fall short. And he covered over 250,000 miles on horseback, on foot, sometimes preaching in four or five or six different places in a day. Wesley did not want to leave the Church of England, but reform it from this token style of faith that it had adopted. The Church of England had become actually quite similar to the Catholic Church that it had broken away from. It was building its own wealth, presuming that church attendance was enough for salvation, rather than a life of faith. And they were tolerating the social problems around it. But Wesley wanted the Church to tackle these issues, but instead, they tried to gag his voice, preventing him from preaching in any Anglican church. In fact, that same trip that I made with Ali and my parents, we passed through Epworth, where John's father had ministered and was buried. You see there, perhaps back one, there we are. That's his father's gravesite, or his father's grave. John would stand on that and he'd preach to the people outside because he was not allowed to preach inside. He did that several times. Frankly, they couldn't have done anything better for Wesley's ministry and the launch of Methodism. Although there were many wanting to retain the link with the Anglican Church, more and more societies were springing up where people who were responding to Wesley's preaching could join and learn together and grow together in faith. These were divided up into Bible classes. You can, there's actually these, little, I'm not sure if they're up there, but see some membership slips if we go in. Another slide further. There we go. There you go. Some Methodist Society membership slips. They divided into these Bible classes and even further into bands to give people even greater support and accountability to each other. However, as helpless these classes were, Wesley couldn't get away from the fact that there were problems out there in society. People were oppressed through unfair financial arrangements. England was crippled through alcohol abuse, and people couldn't access healthcare or employment. Wesley realized that these things were not separate to the issue of people lacking a genuine faith. The two issues were actually linked together. So with his amazing organizational skills, probably learned from his mother, who's aunt, he set up lending societies, medical clinics, resources for medical purposes, and more, while still organizing, appointing, and resourcing great quality preachers and leaders to make sure people were finding and growing in their faith. He invested in lay leaders, not just ministers, that was a novel concept, a number of whom were women. Which was a thoroughly foreign concept in the church ministry at that time. Wesley would be without opposition. He would often be pelted with eggs and rotten food as he preached. There was one incident where a rowdy drunk heckled him loudly from the back of the crowd. When he saw that he was getting nowhere, he climbed onto his horse and tried to run people down. He was unsuccessful, thankfully. And the situation was more under control. But as strange as that was, even stranger was the identity of the drunken, murderous culprit. It was a local church priest. In spite of many other episodes like this, which led John Wesley to wonder if he hadn't preached well enough, if he hadn't received the rotten letters to the head, Wesley's passion, his organisation, his love for people and love for God left behind him at age of 88 when he passed away. At that stage, 79,000 English Methodists and a further 40,000 American Methodists, some 470 buildings to house a number of the societies that had grown, and he birthed a denomination that would be active in discipleship and mission throughout many parts of the world, even to the far-flung Australia. In addition, through his passion for seeing the needs and well-being of a whole person met, he had inspired people to pursue these issues, including, among many, William Wilberforce, who would eventually see the abolition of slavery in England. So how do we live in response to what we have heard and seen of Wesley? John Wesley achieved great things in difficult circumstances and opposition. But he was so passionate about the confidence he had in Christ that he could not help but do so. As a congregation that has received his legacy, how do we now go about living in response? The first one, we need to live a whole of life faith. One of the greatest things that Wesley's mission affirms for us is that faith is everything. It's for everything, it's in everything, and it fills everything. There is absolutely no part of our lives that it does not touch. Wesley looked at the church in England at that time and saw people who would go to church on Sunday morning in their finest, rich and probably ignorant of the social issues around them. If any of the regular people did go inside, they would sit there, they'd understand a little, and then walk back out again to find a few friends to get drunk with. What was more, he saw that the church in England, by and large, didn't actually seem to care, as long as the coffers were full. Wesley didn't believe in that kind of church because he didn't believe in that kind of God. God is Lord, 24/7, 365. This year, 366. It's a leap year. He has given us such a wonderful gift in forgiving our sins, which is wonderful. It's something we couldn't imagine that he could do for us. But he didn't just save us from sin. He saved us for a life transformed by the Spirit. As we read this morning from Romans 12, the worship God merits from us isn't to sacrifice an animal, or our work, or our holidays, or our money on a weekly or monthly basis. The worship God merits from all of us is everything that we are. When you sacrifice something, it isn't just supposed to be handed over for a little while before you then go and take it back again. It's completely given over to God, devoted to him and his purposes. Wesley knew that. If people hung on to just a little bit of their old lives, they were soon going to be pulled back away from their faith entirely. That was why he invested so much effort to create systems that would stop that from happening. Faith is not a part-way exercise. If we are not fully given to it, eventually Satan will use that to just slowly, subtly, pull us away from the faith which he has given us. Instead, we need to keep pressing into God. There is more than enough for you and I to keep learning and growing for 200 years if we can live that long. Wesley urged people to work hard at their holiness, making themselves ready for God's work. After all, what higher purpose is there? So let's give it to one another to make that our lifestyle. The second one, a whole of life mission. It isn't that long ago that evangelical mission, Christians and social concern Christians were almost opposite sides of a totally different fence. The evangelical Christians would say that to address the social needs of a community meant that we could ultimately end up diluting the emphasis of sharing the message of how God could save people for their eternity. On the other hand, the social concern Christians would say, Jesus spent so much time on healing, on rescuing, on liberating people, that as his followers, that is where we should be investing our efforts. But it's a false dichotomy. It's a false separation. Jesus did both of those things, and so did the early church. And Wesley did the same, realizing that for a person to be truly saved, they have to be saved spiritually into a relationship with Jesus, where they can keep growing, and a community where they can be nurtured and serve others. But he couldn't just stop there, because they also needed to have their needs for health, for employment, and a means to live met as well. For a person to be saved, the whole person had to be saved, not just one aspect. Now, that can happen in various ways. In our previous congregation, we saw a few people in need, and yes, we were able to look after them in some of the ways they needed. But that actually wasn't the greatest need in that area. With people coming from other countries, a number had come because they had been looking for some kind of help and assistance. Not because they were destitute, but like all of us, they had some kind of issue in their life as they had come to Australia, and they now needed some help as to how to live here. For some, it had been help with personal or family issues. For others, it was help with English, just learning how to live and speak the language here. And with others, it was help to try and find a job. And so understanding that churches are places where you can find help, they came to us. And we were able to help. For most of those people, the congregation were able to offer them some help or support. But beyond that, they were able to offer them community, a group of people with whom they could belong and become a part, to which they actually invited others in the end. And some of them also discovered the love and saving work of Jesus and became people who are committed to him and saved for an eternity with God. Of all the needs that any of us have, that has to be the greatest thing. And they found it through the first step of finding people who are willing to help them and meet their needs. Look for those around us who have needs. We have a housing estate not 500 metres from our church. A number of people there need help. And then there are people who are shut-ins, either at home or in a care facility. It was just last week I met with some people from Allity Care, just down on Walkville Terrace. They asked for worship service and some pastoral care. Now that's not just for me to do. I'll do it. But anyone can be involved. In fact, it would be great if all were involved. You don't have to be in minister to do these things. Look for opportunities to show God's salvation to those around you who are in need. God has put them there in that issue for a reason. Maybe you're the one he wants to use to help meet those needs and indeed their greatest need for life in Christ. Let's pray. Our gracious God, we thank you. We thank you for the life that we have in you. A life that you have granted us by your grace that we can access through faith. Lord, we thank you that you continue to reveal yourself through the scriptures as we pray, as we spend time together and learn from each other and share our faith together. But Lord, there is so much more you call us to be. We are to be your hands and feet in this world. We are to be your voice. We are to be in places where you would go. Lord, we pray that you would help us to that you would open our eyes to see these places, to see the people, to offer our help as we're able. And where we can't, perhaps get some help to do so. Lord, we pray that you would continue to open up our opportunities